Welcome to this third video in the series on the Sears Silvertone model number 7239 stereophonic tape recorder from the mid-1960s. In this video, we're going to be looking at the mechanical chassis, and we'll also be looking at the motor and a test of the motor to make sure that it is running properly. This video and all future videos will be very detailed and a full documentation on the construction of this machine. The patent drawings are conceptual. The machine is the actual implementation of those patent drawings. It is necessary for me to make a visual record of what is actually happening in the machine because it is so rare and because there is so little documentation other than the patent drawings about it. This video is actually a record for me more than it is for you on YouTube, because if I ever have to get back into this machine, I'm going to need this video record to guide me. This machine is very unique. It is extremely clever. It is an invention in the purest sense of the word, so it does need full documentation. So I hope you enjoy the details that take place in this and future videos on this series, and continue watching to see how in this video we see how the chassis was built and how the motor initially works after being restored. Enjoy! Obviously, the most important part of any tape recorder is the record playback head. Now, this Sears stereophonic unit has a unique head arrangement because the whole machine is upside down. The head is actually also upside down. We're looking at it straight on, as if we would be looking at a normal tape recorder where the tape is going from here to here. But in actual fact, this is upside down and the tape goes from here to here, so it travels this way. As a result, the head is a combination head, has the erase section here and the record playback section here. I had to disassemble most of the transport to get to this focus on the head to see it, and when you see the transport later on, you'll see why. But I had to examine it to see if it's viable, because this is, of course, a used tape recorder. I've examined this. There are some scratches, but for the most part, it looks pretty good. There's a little bit of grooving, because this is a guide here, this slot, and over here, there's a slot here, and that's mostly the guide for the head. So, because the pressure pad goes all the way across the head, it was forcing the tape to cut a groove in the head. When I looked at it using a loop, which is one of those high-powered magnifiers that jewelers use, I couldn't really see any gap. And if you can't see gap, that's a good sign. The pole pieces are the silver pieces in the center of the blue section. And there's a gap in the middle of each pole piece. If you can see the gap, it's probably too large. Even under the loop, I could not see the gap. Therefore, I think it's perfectly okay. If you see anything on the erase head, it's not that critical because the erase head is not doing any kind of sound recording. It's simply realigning the magnetic particles on the tape. There's a transport plate that I'm showing you here that moves forward and backwards relative to the head and presses the tape against the head. You can see it right here with this brass piece carrying a red felt pressure pad, and I'll press on that with my swab, and you see how that works in this system. The red felt is a replacement. The felt that was there actually had, it looked like little moth holes, so I had to take it off and replace it, and this is piano felt. And this plate moves back and forth, pushing this pressure pad against the head. You can see why I had to take the plate out to examine the head, because when the plate is in position, you can't see the head. The transport, which moves back and forth, also carries the pinch roller on this arm. You can see the hole there that aligns with a set screw for it. That part comes out, so when I've taken it out, it just leaves me with the transport for that so that I can clean it and so on. But what's significant is, and is very crucial to the operation of this whole machine, is this little notch right here. Not this one, this one. And the reason that's significant is because there is a component that locks the transport in the forward position. And that component is this piece here, which has a rotating pin. Now, you'll see this all put together, but that rotating pin locks in that little notch right there. Do you see how that's going together there? And I have to show you like this, because when I put this together, you're not going to be able to see it. And we can look at it upside down so you can see how it works. It locks right in like that. And that holds the transport against the spring which is trying to return it. It holds it so that the pressure pad is up against the head and the pinch roller is against the capstan. I had to show it to you like this because once it's assembled, you will not be able to see this amazing critical notch. If this fails, the transport will shut itself off all the time. I replaced the plate, as you can see here, and it has this spring which goes from the plate to the deck, and that pulls in this direction. So that's what causes the plate to withdraw. Now, using my thumb, I'm going to move the plate forward as if it was turned by the catch. You see how it goes forward? And you see how here the pressure pad assembly swings back because it's pressed against the head. Now, obviously, it doesn't press that hard against it. It's a little bit less than that, which you'll see later when I get the other parts in. And this is that all-important locking notch. The pinch roller carrier mounted, and you can see here's the pivot screw for it. And so you can see that there's this spring. This is the pinch roller pressure spring. And it moves slightly. And it's getting harder to work this because, of course, it's getting more complicated. But as I move this forward with my finger, you see that that will help it move out of the way. And there's quite a bit of spring pressure here. That's the way tape recorders work. They're a balance of spring pressure. This is the forward stop lever. This is the fast forward rewind lever. We're looking at this whole thing upside down. So you have to remember that when we look at the tape recorder when it's completed, these will be in opposite positions. The lever here for the stop and start has a cam right here with a hole in it. That hole accepts a crankshaft. In the patent, they call it a bell crank. So it takes this bell crank, which is just simply a wire that has a funny shape to keep it locked into the hole here. That goes over to this hole in this eccentric piece that we looked at, which is the locking mechanism. That hinges on this post here, and it's held in place by an E-clip. There's another bell crank. It's a wire, and it goes along here to this piece here, which we'll look at in more detail later. Which it works the brake assembly and pushes it out of the way. So when this rotates, remember that that collar, not that collar, but that pin we were looking at, which has to lock into the hole in the plate here, this is what's going to turn and grab. So let me turn this and you'll see. You see how it's pushing it? And then it grabs it. So it just barely grabs it. And the more you turn the knob, it doesn't make any difference. It's not going to move any further. That may be how the machine broke. The knob broke because people tried to turn it too hard. And it's very easy to trip. You see that? And it's because of all the spring pressure. So it does seal and it does lock, but it's a hair trigger. And it wants to come back this way. So it's harder to make it do that than to do that. Now, this lever, which controls the fast forward and the rewind, works some mechanisms underneath the plate that we'll look at in a little bit. But what's important is there's a plate here, and that's the locking plate for it. Now, you see how the plate moved over, and you see there's a slot in the transfer plate here that is similarly shaped to this slot here, so that it prevents this from being able to turn. Again, if you were to try to turn it and force it, of course you could break the knob, and that may have been what happened. Then neutral, then this is the rewind or the fast forward. We're upside down, so it's hard for me to tell. And again, this can't really move because it's blocked right here. Now, when this is in place and it is working to run the tape through in the normal mode, if you try to turn this, the plate is going to bang against the edge here. So let me get my hand out of the way there. You see how it bangs up against there? So that's how they interlock it to prevent jumping from fast forward into play, or rewind into play, or play into fast forward or rewind. You have to go play or record and stop, rewind or fast forward or rewind and stop. And then you can work it. You can't work both knobs at the same time. This bar is controlled not only by this lever here, as we could see. You see how it moved out of the way? And when I turn this, it's also going to go out of the way. That actually works this patented brake thing that we were talking about. You see up here? This is the actual brake. Now, to understand how that works, we have to look at the bottom of the spindles. Here is a really awful looking spindle. I still have to get it all cleaned up and everything. But this is the bottom, and it has a keyway here that will match a rod that comes through here that has a keyway on it. And that keeps it turning with the rod. And you see that it has this cork material. You see that's all wrapped around there? And that's epoxied to the metal piece itself. So when it's sitting on the shaft like that, maybe you can get the idea that this plate here will rub against this cork here, and that causes the breaking. Now remember, this is upside down. Everything hangs, so the brake wants to fall against this cork piece. I think that's one of the secrets of why it was an invention. But when we work the lever, the rewind lever, you see how this pulls it back? So it pulls it off enough, and you'll also see here, these are actually arms here, which we're going to see when we flip it over, and they move this way to tighten the tension on the fiber belts. We have to look at the bottom side of the machine to understand it. This is a very complicated arrangement. So this one moves out of the way, not out of the way, but it moves to increase tension between the belt here and the motor, which is going to be located right underneath there. And then when it's turned back, you see how it would go towards the motor, so it'll loosen. Same thing is happening now on this side and back. Now when it goes into play, this also goes over, but it doesn't go over with the strength of the spring strength that it does with fast forward. So this is actually the take up. This is the feed. It's very complicated because it's upside down and it's backwards. Now finally, what are these red rubber, what are these red things? Well, they had a bunch of black felt discs here on every one of these bumps because that's what the plastic faceplate goes against, and they didn't want it to vibrate. Now most of those had kind of rotted, so I'm replacing them with piano punchings. This brake just floats here, that's all it is. The pin, this very long pin, it's very flexible, goes through a hole in here and a hole in here and holds the plate so it can't really move except when activated by the pin at the end of this arm. Thus, it's a free-floating brake. It doesn't have to move very far, it just has to be off the that cork business. And again, it also goes out of the way when we push that into play. It reminds me a little bit of the cassette brakes. So I don't know how effective this is going to be because it's 50 years old, of course, and that cork looks like it's not worn, but it's smoothed because of all of the work that it has done in the past. It is a used tape recorder. And then finally here is the pinch roller. And if it looks really, really clean, I scrubbed it and cleaned it. And the rubber is pretty good on it, so I think it's going to be able to work. And it sits there, and obviously the capstan goes through this hole here. So the screwdriver will pretend it's a capstan. See, and then when I put it into play, well, if I can do it. So then when I put it into play, you see how it will press against the capstan. I have the capstan out for cleaning right now. This is the underside of the deck, and what we see here is the capstan flywheel and the two spindles. This is the take-up spindle, and this is actually the feed spindle, because this is the orientation which the machine actually works. The controls are up here. This is the inside of the control for the fast forward and rewind, and then this control here works the forward and stop for record and playback. The capstan is held in place simply by a clip that holds it in a bearing. There is no back bearing here. It turns quite freely. So it is designed to work in that position vertically, not horizontally. The spindles here, the tables for the spindles, have a fiber belt going around within a groove here that I'm showing you here. And the motor, which is going to be located here, I've got it out temporarily so I can work on the unit, goes here and feeds both these spindles as well as obviously the capstan. The capstan has a rubber belt. These both use a fiber belt. Now, let's take a look at the fast forward and rewind functions, which is managed by this control here. In rewind, notice that this table will go in this direction. And when it travels in that direction, that will stretch the belt so that it will be tight against the motor pulley and this pulley so that it will work, it'll have the tension to work as a rewind function. And then when it's released, it moves out of the way and the belt will be loose. Then for fast forward, this will do the same thing. And we can see in here the brake assembly, and notice that the brake assembly goes up and down. So the brakes are lifted off, the brakes are assigned, the brakes are lifted off. And so that's how that works. And there is a mechanism here which cuts off the automatic cutoff switch, which is removed right now because that's part of the wiring to the motors, which you'll see later. This pivot here also has a special secondary pivot for the take-up table, and that works in the forward mode. So you can see in the forward mode, the table goes over to get tension, but it's not as much tension as it would have in the fast forward. And next we're going to take a look at the motor. The Sears tape recorder had a very large motor in it. It's a four-pole motor. They call it a heavy-duty four-pole motor, but they don't say whether it's synchronous or not. Now, the problem that this motor had was, of course, that it was just filled with dust. And hair and stuff like that all got inside the machine, and then the motor was totally clogged up. So there are four screws, 1, 2, 3, 4, with bolts, and you can unscrew them, and then you can lift these plates apart. You don't want to take these plates apart, but, you know, take this cover plate or this back plate. You don't want to move this back plate because the wiring goes through it. So you hold this back plate to this coil here, or not coil, but this set of plates, and you move the front plate off. that's going to take the whole rotor with it because the pulley there is going to keep it together. And then you can get inside and you can clean it and oil it. And this thing was very, very thirsty. It hadn't been oiled for a very long time. Well, let's take a look at the pulley, which does not come off. How they put this on here, I don't know. But it's, believe it or not, it's a five-step pulley. It has two flat pulleys right here, one and two, and those run the fiber belts for the take-up and rewind. Then there's a one, two, three-step pulley there, and that's for the three speeds that work with the rubber belt. Now, here is a sample rubber belt, and just to show you how it fits, you see there's how it would fit in there. I've ordered the proper belt for it. I was hoping this belt would work, but it's too small. And the belt that came with it stretched so far that it was completely useless. 3 3/4 has little forks on it, as does the thing for the 7 1/2. And what happens is that as it spins, they're not forks, they're prongs. They catch the belt and force it down to the next level or force it up to the next level, depending on the fork. I'm not showing you because it's in another part of the shop right now, but there's a fork that manages the speed control. We'll look at that when we get this all put back together. Right now, the most important thing is to see how well the motor is going to perform now that it's been completely cleaned and lubricated, which is what it really needed. And it's running pretty smoothly by hand. It feels, you can see that, you look at that. So you can see, you know, how it's working there. But I wanted to run it under power to see how it's working. Now, one of the things was I've replaced the original power cord with a modern power cord that has a polarized plug. And this is very important because it prevents, you know, a shock hazard. Although this tape recorder is so well insulated, you probably wouldn't get a shock anyway. But the original cord did not have a polarized plug on it, and it was also very stiff. So I bought this power cord at my hardware store, and I wired it up properly so that the polarized, which is the neutral, is going directly into the rest of the circuitry, and the hot, which is this one, is going into the switches, so you can cut off the hot, but the neutral will stay connected. And I'd read in several places on the internet that that's what you're supposed to do. Now, what you can't see in this view is all the extra wiring that's attached to the motor. There's an example of some of it for one of the switches. I'll zoom out after we run our test. But right now, we just want to run a test to see how the motor is going to perform, and especially what kind of noise it's going to be putting out. And you can see that the motor is running. If you look at the pulley there, I'll stop it so you can see it spin down. There you go, start it up again. Watch this pulley. It's pretty quiet. Hearing a little bit of noise, a little bit of vibration. This is a 50-year-old motor. It's been through a lot. There may not be much more I can do about it. I also want to see what effect the fan has, and the fan is pressure fit to the back here. So this is the motor, and we'll just turn it off now. And it spins down pretty well. Now this is the fan, and it just pressure fits on the back. So you can see that. Let me move this forward a little bit. All right, so let's see if this is going to work okay. Occasionally you're going to hear some noise from the fan, but it seems to be working. Let me zoom out a little bit. So that's running nice and quiet. Now what I'm going to do is I'll give it a full 20-minute test of running. So I'm going to leave it running and we'll come back and see how it's doing. This motor has been running for about a half an hour now. I'm going to turn it off and take a temperature reading. And look at how nicely it spins down. You can see the meter over here, and it's registering an ambient temperature of around 70, 71 degrees. This is my temperature probe. This is in Fahrenheit because this is being done in Massachusetts in America, and we do Fahrenheit. So here we go. Take a test here. I'm going to just hold the probe onto the case. It's kind of peaking around 96, 97. Probably will go up to 100 if I hold it here for much longer. 98. That's really very good. That's excellent because many of these motors get much hotter than that. We'll take a look at how this mounts into the machine and we'll give the machine a test when the new belt arrives and I have it all test assembled. This is as far as we're going to go with this particular video. Thank you for watching this video, number 3 in the series on the Sears Silvertone, model number 7239. You can see other videos in the series by looking in the clydesight channel or going to the clydesight channel playlist, Sears Silvertone, model 7239. Thank you for watching this video and for watching clydesight productions channel on YouTube.